Tonight, I would like to give you some insights into the exciting area of neuroplasticity, as well as some concrete examples. This model of the brain has been used for the last 400 years, and it has well-defined regions, and those regions do not change. This led to important conclusions about the brain. When brain cells failed to develop properly or were damaged, they could not be replaced, and the brain could not alter its structure or find new ways to function once it was damaged. And I just have to warn you that there will be a quiz at the end of this presentation. This slide is the current model of the brain. Actually, this is what your brain looks like after you raise teens. A plastic brain, or neuroplasticity, implies that your brain can change, that children are not always stuck with the mental abilities they are born with. A damaged brain can reorganize itself, and old dogs can learn new tricks with ease. The nucleus basalis focuses our attention and helps us remember what we are experiencing. After the critical periods of development in childhood, when the nucleus is always on, it can only be activated when something important, novel, or surprising occurs, or when we make the effort to pay close attention. That's important, it might be on the quiz. This is Cheryl. Her balance system was destroyed by an antibiotic. Consequently, she can hardly stand on her own and always feels like she is falling over. The helmet she is wearing has an accelerometer built into it that feeds information to electrodes on her tongue. From the moment she put the helmet on, the sense of falling left her. Paul Bakke built the helmet Cheryl is wearing and is one of the pioneers of sense substitution. His first device was a chair that allowed blind people to see images through vibrating sensors on their back. The original version, built in the 60s, weighed over 400 pounds. The new version weighs a few ounces and mounts on a pair of glasses. Like the helmet, it works through electrodes stimulating the tongue. The PONS device is the interface that sends those signals. Bakke's team found that just programming the PONS to send random impulses to the tongue can help people with multiple sclerosis regain motor function and speech. Michael Mersenich was probably the first person to use the term neuroplasticity in the published literature. His original work was on cochlear implants that bypass the damaged parts of the ear and feed sound signals directly to the brain. He proved with a series of experiments that brain maps do in fact change over time. He has taken his knowledge of brain maps and turned them into practical inventions that help sharpen perception and memory and heal learning problems. His team of scientists developed software programs that redesign the brain by training specific processing areas to do more mental work. He believes that IQ can be improved. A set of identical twins was enrolled in our Montessori preschool, one neurotypical, the other exhibiting a lack of awareness of other people and obsessive behavior. We gave him four 13-day treatment sessions of sound therapy program known as the Tomatis Method. He now exhibits neurotypical behavior and is more advanced academically and socially than his twin brother. Alfred Tomatis developed this method and a device he called the electronic ear in the 1950s. Originally to help opera singers regain damaged areas of their vocal range. He discovered the voice only contains what the ear hears. If hearing is modified, the voice is immediately modified, and it is possible to permanently change speech by means of auditory stimulation. The Tomatis method uses the ear as a gateway to the brain. The ear not only transmits sound to the brain, but also transmits information about balance. By stimulating the ear in specific ways, it is possible to strengthen the auditory reflex and retune the cortex to respond to different frequency ranges. This little girl had an inability to coordinate her movements. She could not speak clearly and was not potty trained at age 4 1/2. In our Montessori environment, she could not sit still or focus on a lesson. After we gave her 7 days of sound therapy, she potty trained herself. After 15 days, her speech began to clear and she began to focus on lessons. The Tomatis method uses modified classical music that has been sent through a series of sound processors. Because of the unpredictability that has been added to the music, it forces the brain's processing centers to stay engaged. This facilitates neuroplasticity and allows the brain to rewire itself. Recently, a 69-year-old dentist suffered a major stroke. He was given an experimental drug that saved his life, but he experienced loss of fluid speech and loss of fine motor control. After 3 months of traditional therapy, he still had not recovered. After 15 days of sound therapy, he was able to speak clearly and tie sutures again. Language exists in different frequency ranges. One theory of autism is that during critical periods of language development, too many neural connections are made, overwhelming the nervous system. Sound therapy can help reset neural connections for specific language frequencies, bringing back unwanted frequencies and making it easier to learn new languages. Nutrition is a vital component of neural development. 50% of the oily part of synaptic membranes in the brain are made up of DHA fatty acids. If the body does not have enough DHA, it uses inferior materials that can lead to anxiety, depression, poor memory, and poor reaction time. Exercising your brain is one of the most positive things you can do to promote healthy neural networks. Learning something new and challenging like a foreign language, taking up an instrument and learning to read music, or practicing on specifically designed software can help your brain stay young and healthy. And I don't think watching videos on YouTube or Netflix counts. Norman Borish is one of the leading experts on neuroplasticity, and he has written two amazing books on the topic from which I have borrowed liberally. These books chronicle many other discoveries from the frontiers of neuroscience. Both books are entertaining and include references to published studies. Based on my research, 95% of all learning disorders and many developmental delays can be corrected with the neuroplastic technology currently available. Many of these children are brilliant and try much harder than their peers. They just need a little help with the underlying neural structure. Research also indicates that there is hope for older brains as well. Okay, I warned you there'd be a quiz at the end of this presentation. I want to see a show of hands of how many people think yes, the brain can change. Okay, how many people say no? There's some no's out there? Still a few skeptics. Well, maybe some brains don't change, but most brains can change with the right stimulation.